Good morning. Today's scripture is found in Revelation 22, verses 14 to 15. Blessed are those who wash their robes, that they may have the right to the tree of life and may go through the gates into the city. Outside are the dogs, those who practice magic arts, the sexually immoral, the murderers, the idolaters, and everyone who loves and practices falsehood. This is the reading of God's word. You may be seated.
What can wash away my sin? What's the answer to that? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. That song, Forgiven Forever. Do you believe that? How many of you believe that? That you have been forgiven forever. I'm not going to ask you to stand and affirm that, but I would like you to realize that that is what Easter is all about. Jesus rose because he has granted forgiveness by his blood. I have spoken to some of you many times about this, and I asked you many times, are you sure you have been forgiven? Although you may have done the worst kind of sin against God himself first and against somebody else, a fellow human being perhaps, that you have asked for forgiveness. You know, many times this thought keeps going back to our minds, because unless there is forgiveness in your life, it's hard to move on, isn't it? It's hard to trust. It's hard to make sense of what's happening in your life, because you have all this bitterness, anger in your heart, and perhaps mixed with a bit of sadness and despondency. But there is hope, right? You see that linen cloth there on the cross, and you see it everywhere you pass a church, displayed in its front lawn or perhaps in cemeteries, that in this life there is always hope. We hear that in our Tagalog, in our Proverbs in the Philippines, right? Kung may buhay, may pag-asa. Hindi may pagkain, ha? And sometimes we make a joke out of it. If there's life, there is hope. But what if there is no hope? What happens to life? If there is no hope, there is no life. And that is why, although our Lord Jesus Christ died on the cross, he didn't remain dead. Last Friday, I told you, we may have the darkness of our nights cover our hearts with guilt, with shame, with sadness. And in my own experience, I've told you about my personal problem that I'm going through with my daughter. My eldest daughter, who has cancer, and for a while I thought she was in an advanced stage of cancer. And that brought me into a state of sadness and despair. But I have been preparing for this sermon, and I want to share you what God told me about her condition and what she would look forward to, and what I should look forward to in this sickness. Because a few days ago, I received God's answer to our prayers. We have all prayed. And I have good news that Celine is now been scanned, CT scan, and her cancer is limited to her nodes, the lymph node, one lymph node, her side of her chest and her breasts. So that's one good news. But there's also a bone scan, I believe that's what it's called, on Wednesday, to determine if it's spread through the bones. And we are still all praying for that. Why do we pray? We pray because we know we have a God who lives, who is alive, and is therefore able to help us. He is the God of the living and not of the dead. Because this morning's sermon, if you take out your four W's, now in this church we have been following CCF, Christ Commission Fellowship, in the past. But this time you'll get something different. Because I believe CCF hasn't preached this sermon yet. It's one that I got from the Lord as a message to you this morning. Firstly, to myself. Because if any of you have some things that are causing you a bit of despair and discouragement, I hope today's sermon will bring you hope. Because what if Jesus did not resurrect? What if Jesus did not rise from the dead? And this is the only faith, the only religion, if you like, where Jesus rose from the dead. The God who came down as a man did not die forever. All the other religions, their prophets or their gods, are not like Jesus who rose from the dead. Does the resurrection of Christ impact your life? If you read under welcome, that is the question I want to answer this morning, if possible. And perhaps you could start thinking about this. What if he didn't resurrect? How does the resurrection of Christ impact your life? Does it affect your days, your decisions, your goals, career, commitments, finances, and future? How? And the word we have today is found in all of these verses, but let me start off by telling you the first blank in your program, the sermon outline, if you like filling that up. The word that should go there is the word what? Provisions to life. What is the provision in your life and mine? Is it man-made? What is it? It's supernatural. It's supernatural. A few months ago, one of you asked me this question. In Genesis 2:9, Pastor, a mention is made of a tree called the Tree of Life. Now, I follow whatever the Holy Spirit leads me to preach. And whenever one of you asks this question, I make it a part of my sermon and address this question that was asked. Because you know there are two trees mentioned in Genesis, right? The tree of life and the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, both of which are in the Garden of Eden. So in Genesis 2:9, what do we find? Pastor RJ, please put up 2:9. Thank you. So as I mentioned the verses, Pastor RJ will put them up. It says, "The Lord God made all kinds of trees grow out of the ground." This is the Garden of Eden, where our first parents, Adam and Eve, were. And some of you know this. Story of creation. "Trees that were pleasing to the eye and good for food." In the middle of the garden were the tree of life and the tree of knowledge of good and evil. That's in God's word. And all the trees were good to the eyes, or pleasant to the eyes, and good for food, it says. So which of these trees do you think Adam ate of? Well, firstly, before he ate of, some of you would say the apple, no? There's nowhere in the Bible that says an apple. Maybe that's the computer company Apple's promotion, no? Because it has a bite in it, right? I don't believe that. It wasn't an apple. So before Eve ate of the fruit, should be careful, I was about to say apple too. Before Eve ate of the fruit and gave some to who? The husband. by the way, somebody told me, Pastor, doesn't that show that somebody asked that the source of our all evil is the woman? No? My answer was, I mean, I had to explain, of course, because that seems to be the impression. But the point is, Adam didn't have to listen, right? But he was silent, and he took it and ate of it. By the way, before I go on, remember this. What did Jesus say? And may I ask the men to bring in the communion to the front too, so we're ready for it. The whole table, please. What did Jesus say in the Last Supper about the Lord's Supper, the communion elements? What did he say? He said what? This is my body, which is broken for you. Take and eat. Right? Later we're going to do that. But in this beginning of Genesis, God said, you may take and eat of any of the fruit, including the tree of the knowledge of good. I'm sorry, including the tree of life, but not of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. What happens when they eat of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil? They will surely die. And that's why we have physical death. And that's why there is also a thing called eternal death. So when you die, physical death, and you don't believe in Jesus Christ, and you don't know what these elements mean, then you will die an eternal death. Whereas, in the Garden of Eden, Adam ate of any of the trees of the garden, especially the tree of life. And if you follow your four W's, what does it say? The tree of life imagery was consistently revealed in the Bible from Genesis through Revelation. What is it a symbol of? It's a symbol of both eternal life and continued blessings. Do you hear that? Do you see it? So in Genesis 2, verse 9, it's a real tree with special properties to sustain what? To sustain eternal life. It was placed in the Garden of Eden where Adam must have observed it, ate of it, and thus sustained his life. If you want to read that, it's in verse 16, but we'll keep going. Such a tree, symbolic of eternal life, will also be in the new heaven and the new earth. What you read this morning in the call to worship, that tree of life in the Garden of Eden, which sustained eternal life, is present in Revelation. When the new heaven and the new earth comes, and man is able to live with God eternally again. Do you follow? Both from Genesis all the way to Revelation is the tree of life. Not the Christmas tree. No? In our Christmas celebrations, we celebrate the Christmas tree as giving life to the family. But God has another intention for what the tree should be. He who hung on the tree is able to give you the tree of life. So all this talk about trees, all this talk about the fact that the tree of life is there, because when Adam and Eve were in Eden, they had eternal life. Why? Because they regularly ate of it. While they trusted God, our 4W says, by obeying his command not to eat the tree of the fruit of the other tree, the tree of knowledge of good and evil, our first parents could freely eat from the tree of life. They had access to it. Why? Because they were in the right relationship with God. The only way to have access to the tree of life is to have the right relationship with God. Many of you have experienced in the past having a life that is away from God, where God was not in the picture of your life. And because of that, in your relationships with others, whether it be in your marriage or in your family life, since God wasn't in the picture, your life was a mess. My life was a mess. All of us experienced that one time or other in our life. To be separated from God is to be separated from the tree of life, from the life that sustains our relationship with God. Amen? That's the first point. But there is hope for Adam and Eve, right? We know that because they ate of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, they were banished or barred from eating of the tree of life. And that's your second blank that you have there. That's the result of sin. Again, this same person asked me the question, Pastor, why was there an angel placed on the entrance to the Garden of Eden? A cherubim, a sentry, placed there with a flaming sword, the one that turns around, so if anybody tries to get in, no, the sword will cut him to pieces, right? Why was there an angel charged to guard the entrance to the tree of life, or the Garden of Eden for that matter? Look at this. Adam and Eve disobeyed and failed. They and the rest of mankind were barred from eating of the tree of life. And the angel stood on guard. This is in Genesis 3:24. After he drove the man out, he placed on the east side of the Garden of Eden cherubim. Cherubim is plural, right? So it's not just one angel. It's angels. Anytime you have a Hebrew word with imminent, it means it's plural, cherubim. And a flaming sword flashing back and forth to guard the way to the tree of eternal life. That's what's in the Bible, the tree of life. Okay. Why am I placing so much emphasis on this barring from the tree of life? Because like Adam and Eve, you and I were separated from the love of God who created us and His life-giving tree. Their sin and ours brings us darkness and death. We just sang a song that said, forgiven forever. No death, no life, nor anything can separate us from the love of God. Unlike the result of the sin of Adam and Eve of disobedience, we might say all people since then have been trying to find their way back to Eden. Milton wrote the book, Paradise Regained. And he had in mind the restoration of Eden. There are many, many things, so many movies that depict this goal of regaining Eden. But there is significance in the death of Christ and His resurrection to the tree of life. There's a connection here. Bear with me and let's keep going. Because at the end of this sermon, you would know why we who are believers and followers of Christ live with hope and know for sure that this hope awaits us so we can partake of this tree of life, so we can have eternal life and be sure of it. There are two types of people described in our passage in Revelation 22, verse 14 and 15. So let's look at that. So if you turn to the back of your four W's, we go on with this. Two types of people. The first type of person, as it says in Revelation 22, 14, are the blessed ones. We've been studying this in the Sermon on the Mount. Blessed doesn't only mean happy. Blessed are people who are flourishing, who are whole. Men and women who are made whole again because of their relationship with God. So much so that their life indeed is happy and joyful as you would have it because they are connected to God. And some of you are beginning that journey, that you want to find out what it means to actually walk that path of being related to God in your own life, in your relationships, in your marriage. And some of you have started way back, but you have come to a stall because there have been some strains in your relationship, and perhaps even your relationship here in the church. But don't let that hamper you, because you are described as these blessed people, are those who are washed. Your robes. Okay, what does that mean? A robe is a symbol of what? Being noble, being kingly, no? Or majestic. So in heaven, this is the description of what happens in heaven, you will wear robes, a kingly attire. Why do I say this? Because the tree of life will be there for you to access. You will have the right to the tree of life. You will have eternal life because of that tree. And notice it says you may go through the gates into the city. Last week, Pastor RJ just preached the sermon about the narrow gate and the wide gate. The narrow gate leads to eternal life, right? So it says broad and wide is the gate that leads to destruction, to eternal death. But narrow is the road and the gate that leads to eternal life. And that's what it quotes. The gates are there. And this is what Pastor RJ referred to last time as being sure of your salvation. Are you sure you're going to enter the small gates, the narrow road? You're going to walk in that because that's the only path that leads to life. And what is that narrow road? If you look at your four W's, and we're almost there, you just have to go through this. Eden is restored. So if you want to fill in the next blank, there's restoration of Eden. Paradise is regained. Praise God. We regain access to the tree of life, and we can enter the city gates of the kingdom of God through the death of our Lord Jesus Christ. Our robes were washed in the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. What can wash away my sin? Nothing. Nothing, absolutely nothing, but the blood of Jesus. We are redeemed. We are forgiven by the sacrifice of the Lamb of God. As it says in 1 Peter 1:18, Pastor RJ, 1:18. The next one. Do we have that? Yes. For you know that it was not with perishable things that such as silver or gold that you were redeemed from the empty way of life handed down to you from your ancestors. But how were you redeemed? You were redeemed. The next verse. By what? 19? Pastor RJ, verse 19. Do you have it? No. Okay, what were you redeemed by? By the precious blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. That's okay. We all know this, but we don't really have a personal experience of it many times. So when I was in despair over my daughter's cancer, and I was thinking about this, I know that she's going to heaven. I know that she believes in the Lord Jesus Christ, and the washing of the blood of the Lamb is hers. So she will enter the narrow gate. She will get to the tree of life, and therefore she will have eternal life. But for her and for us who are suffering through this ordeal of finding out how much more time does she have, what will happen to her, her two babies, and her husband, and to us. You see, fear has a way of gripping us into, again, doubting God's promises and God's word. And so he needs to save us from that too. He's not only saving us so we can go to heaven. He's saving us even from our present condition of hopelessness and despair. He's the only one who can wash away your sin of doubting his word, of doubting his ability to make your life flourish and be blessed, even if death is just around the corner. You see, I've made some important points here. We are saved to serve. That's the next point. There it is, 1 Peter 1:19. The precious blood of Christ, a lamb without blemish or defect. Why? Because he didn't sin. and he is 100% man. So only God, only a sacrifice of a man can be acceptable to God, take away his wrath from sin, and to make us acceptable in his sight. Not the blood of animals or the sacrifices of others. You see, we are saved to serve. And that's the other point. We were going through this ordeal of what would happen to my daughter, right? Forgive me if I use this illustration because it was very real when I was making this sermon. Indulge me a bit more. You see, when I was thinking about this ordeal and suffering that my daughter is going through and I'm going through, my wife is going through, the Lord is still telling me, continue to serve. Continue to minister to others who may not have the same hope that you do. Who are in despair because they can't see the light at the end of the tunnel, but you can. And so what did I do? I continued to serve. I continued to do counseling, prepare my sermons, come to the prayer meetings to share the Word of God and to share with others, and to continue to encourage others even though I am getting very much discouraged. But you see, it's when we encourage others that we get to see why the Lord saved us and that we will take our minds off our own suffering and consider that others are suffering too, like us. And perhaps the healing is there because the suffering that we experience is healed by the fact that the tree of life available to all of us in terms of eternal life is also available to us even now. It's already, but it's not yet. But those of us who belong to the kingdom of God know that we are saved to serve. Hebrews 9:14 says that. The resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ from the dead, our consciences are cleared. It says there, the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit, the Holy Spirit, offered himself unblemished to God, cleansed our consciences from acts that lead to death, so that we may serve the living God. So if I continued in my despair and my discouragement because my daughter might not be with us soon, then I would have been committing acts that leads to death instead of serving the living God. I think it's very important for you to realize that no matter what you're going through in life, and I don't discount your suffering and your ordeal, God is still telling you, continue to serve me. Continue to proclaim that there is hope for them in the gospel of the death and resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ. So your heart may be breaking, and you don't know if it's going to work out. Who does anyway? You don't know what tomorrow may bring. You don't know if you will be taken by the Lord anytime, or your loved one taken by God. But you have this one assurance that no matter what you're going through, God is there to pull you through. And God is there to give you the tree of life, even now. You see, dead works is what we normally think of when we do things apart from God. You might say, oh, you're so good, Pastor Dodi. You're such an example to everyone. But let me remind you, it's not because of me. It's because of what God is doing through me, even though inside of me, I'm beginning to doubt things about the Lord's faithfulness to us. But in those times when I do that, then I remember His grace is sufficient. His love is abundant. Because He loved us so much to give His life for us. We were dead in our sins, Ephesians 2:1 says. Ephesians 2:1 says we were dead in our trespasses and sins. And then Galatians 2:16 says, we are incapable of transforming ourselves. We cannot just say to somebody else, pull yourself together. Kaya mo yan. You can do it. That's what the world tells us. That's what our Filipino culture tells us. You are strong. But let me tell you, we are all weak. Weakness is not bad after all. Because in your weakness, you recognize who is strong. That God is the strength of your life. That God is going to pull you through. Even though you are wallowing in self-pity, in pride, in dejection, and saying, I am no good. I am but a worm. Walang kwenta akong tao. I am no good for nothing. I'm not good as a pastor then if I can't be strong for my people, for your people, O Lord. But let me remind you, even as a pastor, if I say I am strong, then I'm giving myself the credit for what rightly belongs to God. Because if I say I am strong, then people will be attracted to me instead of God. If I say I am your Savior, I can help you pull through this, then I'm not pointing them to Christ, who is able to pull every one of us, including myself, through all of life's circumstances. Because I'm not going to be forever here to save you, but Christ lives forever to save you. Amen? So instead of tears this morning, and I know I'm in the verge of tears, I hope I can finish this. We serve the living God. You have been freed from sin because of the risen Christ. Those who are denied access, that's the second part there. That's our verse says that. Outside are the who. Outside are the dogs. The sexually immoral. The adulterers. Those who practice falsehood or lying. These are scary things. You remember the dogs in Matthew 7:6? Do not give pearls to dogs, it says. Those who reject the word of God are not worthy of the gospel. It's sad, but I know that's what the word of God says. We have to concentrate on those who are willing to accept the word of God. Because we know that the day will come when God will speak to them as well. And all we can do is pray for them. Amen? So if there are people who are rejecting the message of the gospel and you feel discouraged, let's say in your family, those who might think that, oh, I'm okay. I don't need all that thing about God. All that talk about having God in your life. That's only for those who are fanatics or whatever. Don't ever make that mistake. You can't build your own life. You can't make yourself happy. That's what the world tells us. You can't create a bucket list and tick off all the things that you want to do in this life and say after you've done them all, I'm good. I'm happy. Because those people who think that way and those who have practiced that know there is nothing that will make life fulfilling. It's all empty. It's all vain. Okay, let me finish with this. Death's final defeat. The word there is defeat. You see, when Adam and Eve were expelled from Eden, there was no access to the tree of life. And so death came. And you wonder, why isn't God merciful to eliminate death? Why does God have to keep death in it? Because even in the punishment of physical death, there is God's grace. Why do I say that? Again, going back to why the angels were placed. so that they can't get back to the Garden of Eden. Imagine this. Adam and Eve, I mean, this is not what happened, but imagine if this is what happened. Adam and Eve sinned, and they died. And suppose in their and they haven't died yet. Suppose they haven't died yet, and they were allowed access to the Garden of Eden and eat of the tree of life. In their fallen state, no? Here they are, sinners separated from God, but they were allowed in. And they were allowed to partake of the tree of life. What will happen to them, do you think? What's wrong with sin? In sin, you have pain, you have suffering, not only for yourself, but for others. And then you say, I want to live forever. What will happen? You will live forever, yes. But you will live forever in pain and in suffering. So God is merciful. He causes all of us to die because He doesn't want to prolong our suffering and pain. We have this saying in Filipino, no? When somebody dies who has been suffering his life, you would tell him, bayaan mo na. Mabuti na yan para hindi na siya maghirap. Natapos na yung kanyang paghihirap. And, you know, in Tagalog it says, you know, let go. It's okay because once a person dies, then all his sufferings are over, right? Especially those who are suffering from the terminal effects of illnesses like cancer or other illness. It is by God's grace that we die. Because God doesn't want us to live in eternal pain and suffering. Death will finally be defeated, however, when Christ returns. But until that time, the agony of death, particularly for those who survive their departed loved ones, and it's even more painful for us when somebody dies, isn't it? Because we are in pain and agony, we should recognize, paradoxically, that this is a gift from God. A paradox is something that seems true, but your whole mind rebels against it because it doesn't seem to make sense. Why would God allow suffering? Yes, He allows suffering, but He also allows death. There's another thought in today's world that says, you make your own truth. You make your own truth. Your opinion is as good as mine. My opinion about this, all that you're saying, is sadly not my opinion. Unless you're Aristotle, who is very smart, you don't make your own truth. You only copy what somebody else has told you. And may I say, unless you are the Lord Jesus Christ, who is the way, the truth, and the life, then all other truths are really lies. That's what the world would want us to believe. That our truth, my truth, is as good as your truth. If that's the case, then there's no truth. Because if everybody's truth is true, then none of them is true. That make sense? Logic dictates that if everybody is lying, doesn't mean that it's the truth. That's because a lot of them say it is. I always remember this, 100 monkeys don't make a wise man. You see, the finality of death, the agony of death, especially for those of us who survive our dear loved ones, is really not pleasant at all. But God uses it to free His children from further pain. I got an assurance from that thought, because I realized that I too am one day going to die. All of us die. But the moment we are born, we begin to die. But the death, when it comes, when death, physical death comes, that's the time that you should remember the best part of my life is about to begin. The best part of your life is not when you retire and have all of these things in hand because you built such a retirement plan. The best part of your life is not when you get married, because your husband or your wife will fulfill your longings that you've been waiting for. Those of us who have been married for a while will tell you that. Not that I'm discounting the fact that I'm happy to have my wife Celia, but I'm telling you, there are more problems that await you when you marry than when you are single than you've ever realized. And that's why some people say, oh, I'm not going to get married. Well, that's the problem. If you live together or just continue to, do that, then you are denying God's truth as well. I'm getting sidetracked, but let me just finish off with this. The choir is going to come up after the communion, right? I'm sorry, I forgot that. So after the communion. Now, let me just close with this. You will have a chance to interact with others in our discipleship group. This may have brought out some issues to you that you've never heard before. So who is this tree of life? Or what is it? I still have to do more research on that. In fact, it's probably a topic for a doctorate, because nobody has written anything about Tree of Life. I know it's late because we started late, but anyway, bear with me. The Tree of Life is the tree that gives eternal life, right? But I would dare to conclude, and this is what some commentators say, the Tree of Life is Jesus. Because when you eat of the tree of life, you have what? Eternal life. That was there from Eden and all the way to the new heaven and the new earth when Eden is restored. What is this? This is the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. Take and eat, Jesus says. Why? Because we are remembering what He's done for us. When He died on the cross, when He rose from the dead, this is what He left for us. Let me give you a final illustration. In the Garden of Eden, I mentioned a while ago, Satan told Eve, take and eat. In the communion, Jesus says, take and eat. Do you see the parallelism, the analogy? It's like Jesus is saying to Satan, look at this, Satan. Watch out. You said to Eve, take and eat, and you gave, and he had ended up in their death, in man's death. Watch this, Satan. Take and eat, and I will give you life. Do you see that? And that's why we always do this. That's why we'll never tire of doing it. We just did it last Friday, Pastor. Why are we having communion again? Are you complaining? Why are you complaining? Don't you want to have life? Don't you want to have eternal life? Well, you don't get eternal life from eating of the bread and the drinking of the wine. But when you remember what Christ has done, then you realize in your mind and in your heart, I will live forever. And that life now starts now with this tree of life that God makes available to you and me. Let's all stand up. I wanted you to stand up because I want you to look here. I want you to look at the front, because it's not a ritual we're doing. A ritual is empty, without substance, all forms. We don't have a fancy table or nice cups. We don't have a ceremony that is long. We don't have servers dressed in white robes. Because we have this invitation from God Himself. It is God Himself who is serving us through your servants in this church, your leaders. So as you meditate on these words that I'm about to say, keep in mind, how does the death and the resurrection of Christ, as portrayed in these elements, affect or impact your life? Does it change anything? Or after taking it, then everything is the same? No. When you partake of this, you realize that you have no other hope but Christ's. You have no other life except through Christ. And you would want to share that hope and that eternal life with others, regardless of how you are feeling right now or in what state you are in. You want your life to be useful to the kingdom of God, not just because you're a pastor, because the Word of God says that we are all, in a sense, pastors serving others, because the word minister means to serve. And the Lord Jesus Christ served us and said this invitation to you and me. The Lord said the night of his betrayal, "This is my body, which is broken for you. Broken so that through the tree of life you may have healing and be made whole. Forgiven of your sins, yes, but also together in your life now. Not broken, not discouraged, but hoping and sure that God is going to come through and bring victory in your life." In the same manner, after supper, and they say this was the third cup, he blessed it and said, "This is the new covenant in my blood. Jesus gave himself for you and me so that we don't have to suffer the consequences of our sin and be barred from the tree of life. But we will have eternal hope that will impact the way we live every day so that we can serve one another. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup," he says, "you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes, because there will be a great feast in the future, and you and I will be part of that great feast."